ask this question. Don't men have shit to carry too? So, like, what's in my purse? Sometimes it's a bar, it's an EpiPen, always an EpiPen. What's the difference between a messenger bag? Because he said he used to carry a messenger bag, like one of those sort of like, and a brief, isn't a briefcase like a men's purse? So, I don't, I mean, I understand that there are many gay men that wear, you know, heels and purses and great. I don't know that many straight men. Why is it really just a female thing? Don't men need to carry their shit with it? They carry an iPad or like paperwork. So a backpack is okay. A briefcase is okay. A messenger bag is okay. But like a crossbody MERS, I think they're calling it. Is that wrong? People used to not online date, and now everybody only online dates. So one day, men will just be wearing purses. Straight men will be wearing purses because one guy just has to wear a purse, and men get to carry their shit with them like we do. I don't know. I feel that I like to have. I like my purse is sitting on my bed waiting for where we're gonna. Oh, reading glasses. That's why men wear like blazers on planes with a lot of pockets. That sounds like a good way to lose everything you own. Okay, you might have a wallet. You have glasses in another pocket, chapstick in another pocket, phone in another pocket. What if you're a checkbook kind of guy? What if you have an allergy? You need your EpiPen. So, like, I don't know. I think we should bring male purses back or in. I don't see a problem with men, male purses. I think they have to be designed properly for heterosexual men and designed properly for gay men. By the way, many gay men don't want to be wearing, like, blinged out purses or logoed up purses. I mean, I just think it's just a functional item. Take it easy, everybody. It's okay to have a male purse. I have no problem with that at all. Listen, if a man was wearing a crossbody bag on a first date, though, I might judge. So maybe I'm a hypocrite. I'm not sure. Let's think about this one. Tell me if you think there's such an ocean between a crossbody bag for a man and a messenger bag and a backpack and a briefcase or a brief bag. It's a brief bag. It's a small bag for everything you need to know. It's called a brief bag. Marketing it here right now. Steal it, take it, let's do it. My next guest is Kathy Ireland, who was a model for decades, then started her brand marketing company, Kathy Ireland Worldwide, where she is the CEO. She founded her company in 1993 and has since grown it into a multi-billion dollar international enterprise. We talked today about how her parents prepared her to be an entrepreneur, how she went from model to mogul, and what it takes to be successful in business and in relationships. I hope you enjoy the conversation. Well, thank you for doing this. I don't know how much you know about this podcast, but this podcast is basically the filter is people who have built a brand, started from the bottom, and now they're here. So I want to just get a sense of your upbringing. I read a little bit about you. It seems like you always were somebody who liked to work, and you seemed to have a structure as a child. Like, so is that because your parents were disciplinarians, or you came from a very traditional, quote unquote, normal background, or what was that like?
I'm blessed to have amazing parents, my mom and dad. I raised my two sisters and me to not have limits. And, you know, as a little girl, I remember my dad saying the prayers at dinner, you know, thank you, God, for making me the richest man in the world. And I grew up thinking we were materially wealthy, which we were not. We never went without. But yet dad was speaking about, you know, just priceless joys of our family. So my dad worked in labor relations. He worked with the farm workers growing up in Santa Barbara. He worked with Cesar Chavez, and as a little girl driving past Oxnard and Camarillo, he'd always point out, like, look, girls, look. And he would point out people who were working in the fields who had no place to relieve themselves with dignity. He would point out people bending over, doing labor that would bring food to our tables with these short hoes because they were less expensive. How people are treated has always been at the forefront of my mind. My mom is my hero. I mean, everything from babysitting business, housekeeping business. Mom would make in the 70s, she made halter dresses that she'd sell at art fairs on the beach. And as like a 6-7 year old, I would make jewelry and handbags that would coordinate with mom's designs.
Wow.
So that entrepreneurial spirit the creativity from my mom, how people are treated from my dad, definitely impacts everything that we do. And we started our brand from my kitchen table. I was an aging pregnant model. We started with a single pair of socks, and we started by conducting surprise factory inspections, because you learn a lot when you show up unexpectedly. And as our company has grown, that's something that we continue today, and it's critical to our work.
Sorry, you said we. So who's we started?
We. So that's our team. And during all the years that I modeled, I was trying and failing at businesses. The modeling career would not have gone on as long as it did had one of those earlier ventures been successful. I learned a lot of powerful lessons along the way. And so I was investing in people, somebody with a great eye who would become our worldwide genius creative director, somebody who understood marketing, someone who would be our vision strategist, this wonderful team. And we've got our millennial team, our Gen Z team. It's really become family.
Well, I want to understand the how we got here. So you were discovered as a young girl by Elite Modeling Agency to just become a model. Just it was something that you were going to do on the side that you thought might be an interesting opportunity. How did that happen? And what age was that?
So, Bethenny, I was 16 and I was a beach rat. I was just, my nose was always peeling. My hair was always fried.
This was in California, in Glendale, right?
This was in Santa Barbara.
Oh, this was in Santa Barbara then. Okay, got it.
Yeah, so it been there since I was 3 years old. And I went to the school, and I was not model material. Yet this was at a time when, like, the look of the moment was changing. And so suddenly one eyebrow was okay. It was like, good. So that was great. So a scout came to the class one day, asked if I'd like to go to New York for the summer. And I said, no, thank you. It just didn't seem like something that I would want to do. And
did you think you were pretty? Like, did you think, I'm sure you didn't think about that, but did you think you were pretty?
No. I didn't. I mean, I really didn't. That had never been a part of my life. And recognizing that it was really eye-opening too, because there were beautiful girls that were not given that opportunity. And so I recognized, you know what? What is beauty? You know, we're all beautiful in different ways, but what the world says, right. I mean, who really cares? It's right. Just very fickle. And it gave me a good understanding of that, something like the emperor's new clothes. Yet that the agency called, they said, we will advance you the money to spend the summer in New York. If you don't like it, you can go home. And so I just figured, you know what? It's an opportunity to earn some money to either go to college or start a business.
Wow. So you were thinking very early. So like didn't even think about the entrepreneurial world until my late 30s. So you really had it instilled in you early. So how many years did you model?
I mean, about 15 years, something like that.
So 15 years, but at the same time, you have these other ideas and you're already aware that you're an entrepreneur. You just had quirky ideas you wanted to execute, or inside, you know that you're a business person.
It was at my every spare moment, you know, meeting with scientists and different experts in different fields to try to learn and grow.
Like, what did you want your business to be? What was your goal? I wish I could X, not model, but this.
Oh, well, I mean, as a child, so many things. I grew up watching Jacques Cousteau. I wanted in scuba diving. I wanted to be an underwater explorer, whatever that looked like. Didn't know how I'd earn money doing that. I wanted to own things and do good with them. I wanted to build things, be creative. It was always, you know, I thought about being a teacher. That was so appealing to me, and having the opportunity to do those passions in different forms has been amazing.
Well, that's interesting that you talk about that, because people now, young people, want to get on the road and rush. They want to, you know, either not go to college, or the second they finish college, know exactly what they're doing. And I didn't really understand what I was or what I was doing. And sometimes I still don't until my late 30s. So what you're describing is a similarity to me, where I always had different jobs, different ideas, did different things, took the road where it took me, thought I wanted to be certain things at a certain time, whether it was an actress or a comedian or a host or a natural food chef or a baker. But I feel that that's valuable, and people shouldn't be pigeonholing themselves and rushing to know. It's about the journey. So you're describing the journey, because through that journey, and I'm sure that all the 20 different ideas and businesses and jobs you had, including modeling, help you now in this bigger empire that you have. You're still calling back, I'm sure, to so many of those different things. And even though you didn't think that at the time they mattered in the future, you're probably pulling things from them now. Is that, would that be accurate?
You are so perceptive, Bethenny. I mean, absolutely. And you're much younger than I am. When I was young, I didn't go to college. It wasn't my path. My formal education ended when I barely finished high school. But I continue to learn and be a student and believe in great education in many different forms. When I was young, kids would graduate from college and find a job. Today, young people need to invent one, and not just one, but like 7, 8, 9, 10 in their lifetime. And so, yes, what you're saying, all of those experiences helped me learn how to pivot at a very young age. That was powerful. The modeling was a wonderful gift in the gift of rejection. I didn't appreciate it at the time.
And you get that in business.
Yeah. Oh my goodness, going door to door, banging on doors, selling our socks, and people laughing in my face, saying what a stupid idea it was, and other things that I won't say, slamming doors in our face. But that didn't stop me. It didn't destroy me. It no meant, well, at least we're talking. I'll come back tomorrow. You know, maybe your circumstances will have changed. Maybe you'll no longer be the person empowered, the decision maker. Maybe you'll be in a better mood. And I do encourage people, if you're getting a rejection, please don't let that stop you. Don't let, if you believe in what you're doing, if you've got passion for it, don't let someone else's opinion of you or your circumstances define or destroy you, and calendar to come back 6 months later if you get a no. I mean, I was probably a little stalky. I'd come back the next day. So maybe wait 6 months. That might be better advice.
So when you go into an airport or a public place, not in Santa Barbara, because I'm sure everybody knows you there, do people think of you as, do people walk up to you and say, oh, you're Kathy Ireland, the model? Or do they think that you're Kathy Ireland, the mogul? The reason I ask that is because sometimes people think I'm from reality TV, and then other people, oh, that's the skinny girl. And you've had a much longer career in both, so I wonder what you are to people.
You know, Bethenny, that's such an interesting question. And for so many years, we intentionally built our brand beneath the radar. And Forbes outed us. They said, we've been clocking you. We're going to do a story with or without your participation. And I love the people at Forbes, and I always appreciate having, especially coming from that shut up and pose background, having my voice heard, especially when it comes to our brand, which I'm so passionate about. And as I get older and maturity, I recognize what a gift it is to break through my shy and selfish shell of quietness to connect with other people. As I get older, I recognize it's a gift to be exposed to needs that are so much bigger than me and opportunities that are so much bigger. In answer to your question, it's wonderful that so often I can go out and nobody knows who I am. They recognize the brand, but maybe not me so much. Younger people don't necessarily know me for the modeling career at all. It's, hey, I grew up sleeping in your princess bouquet bedroom and in your beautiful bed, and I'm getting married now. And I want you to, you know, I want to use one of your estates for my wedding. You know, I want you to, your team to design my gown, my jewelry, all of that. Or it's, you know, hey, I bought this rug. Do you have a lamp that, what, you know, what do you recommend? What should I get? It's more of the business is what I would say.
It's where you are now as an evolved woman. I ask that because I didn't realize that we had parallels. Like, I wouldn't have thought of it this way, but people might not take a model or reality television star seriously. And I like the street cred that a place like Forbes gives you. It makes me feel, I think it's important for women, even though you're under the radar, I think it's important for you to be over the radar, because for women to think that you could come from being what everyone would think of as, oh, just shut up and smile and, you know, models are dumb and that kind of thing, to be, you know, known, respected, to have street cred. I mean, I think that is valid and valuable. You have it.
Oh, thank you, Bethenny. Thank you. And you're such a powerful example of this, Bethenny, of not having limits. I mean, nothing ever stops, and we just keep growing. I mean, our company, from hemp to insurance, home, I mean, office, lighting, sleepwear, intimates next year, sportswear, and the launch of our men's brand, My Six, which means got your back, with Tommy Meharry. He's a Marine. I mean, if you think of Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett is someone I met through Irv Blumkin and at Nebraska Furniture Mart, NFM, and just an incredible business leader. And he introduced us to Warren Buffett. But what he's built with Berkshire Hathaway, it's extremely inspiring. And I would say our company can be defined as a mini conglomerate inspired by Berkshire Hathaway, yet at a much, much, much smaller valuation. We started with socks, and we've sold over a billion pairs of socks, and we keep going. We're opening Kathy Ireland recovery centers throughout the country, and our first one opens in Laconia, New Hampshire this fall. You know, alcohol and drug abuse costs our country billions of dollars. It destroys families, steals lives. And our passion with our partners at Ascension is to break that cycle, regardless of your ability to pay for treatment. And, you know, when you're in that spiral, you either break down or you break through. And for me personally, after faith and family, the work is a major priority because it makes our nonprofit commitments grow. And I have the privilege of serving as international chair of the National Pediatric Foundation, also serving on the board of the NFLPI, the WNBAPA Board of Advocates, the advisory board for the Madison Program at Princeton University, and an ambassador for the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation. Our vision of our company that encompasses all that we do, all the different sectors, are teach, inspire, empower, make our world better. If a potential partner doesn't meet that criteria, we're not a good fit. And how that looks is we have 10 initiatives that we require partners to participate in. And these are nonprofit ways in which they can be involved in. And it involves everything from fighting hunger, supporting education, fighting disease, fighting human trafficking, and supporting our military veterans. And so in order to work with us, that's the first test. We just got to see, what will you do? We don't require a monetary amount. It can be volunteer days, but it's got to be profound and make a difference. And that way, in success, we know that we are really honoring that vision, and it gets our team excited. Sometimes people say, well, why do you still do this after all these years? What keeps you going? And my answer is, my goodness, we have a lot of work ahead of us. In so many ways, we're a baby brand. There's so much to be done, and that's inspiring.
You must have an incredible sense of other people, infrastructure managing from the beginning, to be able to do this. I don't think you're doing this yourself, but still, there has to be, I mean, your skin looks good, you look fresh, you look relaxed. There has to be a way that you are handling this where you still have some sort of a life. You have three kids, you have what seems to be a successful marriage, which we'll get into. How the hell do you manage this? And I want off the ride half the time, and I want to give up half of it so somebody could come in and take it over. So what is that about?
It's, you know what, Bethenny, a lot of times there are hard days, and brand building, as you know, it is hard work. I've been accused of being a control freak. I prefer to think of it as passionate. I am deeply passionate, not just what we do, but how we do it. It's got to be done well. I'm getting much better at delegating, work with an incredible team. But it is important that what we do, that we can just protect the integrity of it. That is important. And the how, it's, you know, people talk about balance, and some days I don't have it at all. Some days I am a mess. But what is key for me to just to go through each and every day is that I honor my priorities. And for me, it's my faith, and then it's my family, and then it's the work. And the minute those orders are, the minute those values are out of order,
okay,
my coping skills are out the window, and I'm not effective at anything. And so I must, and no, I think for women, it can be a hard thing. I was 40 before I learned that no was a complete sentence.
Many people pull at you and you don't see it happening. And it's like any mom who has a couple of kids and doesn't have a business understands this. It's a slippery slope. They're pulling, and if they want you here, and boundaries are so important. I have found, and even more, really sticking to the boundaries, like certain things, you just find that, oh, they're coming over there. They're going to do this tomorrow. I set this up for you. And I keep saying yes. And then I'm like, no, basta. Stop. Like, I'm not an animal. You're sitting behind a desk. I got to be there. Be the talent, be the face, be the thing. So saying no is a discipline. What about your quote unquote, I talk about successful relationships. How long have you been married?
33 years in August.
Okay. So no matter what the behind the scenes dynamics, that would be defined as a successful relationship. And your husband's a doctor?
Emergency room doctor and commercial fisherman.
Okay, so he's, you know, by everyone's standards, a successful man too, by the superficial definition of successful. He has a successful career. So how, you know, I often talk about to different people who are very successful in relationships with other successful people, and I have heard everything from, I don't work on my partner, I work on myself, let they work on themselves. We give each other a long leash. We have our own lives, but come together. So, you know, we check in with each other once a day. I mean, I'm collecting all of this wisdom. So what are the things that you have found to be your threads that have contributed to what you've done right and wrong?
You know, every marriage is, it takes work. It takes a lot of work and good work.
Did it always take a lot of work, even in the beginning?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. It's always been more, I'd say more work in the beginning, a lot more work in the beginning.
Okay.
And, you know, hopefully as we grow older, we keep learning, and I never want to make the same mistakes twice. What's been key in our marriage is that I don't look at it as a contract. It's a covenant with God. And so, there are days when we might not feel like, you know, honoring our marriage with each other. There are days when we might make each other really angry or whatever. It's like, okay, I made a promise to God too. So that relationship helps me to see my husband and others, you know, other relationships too, through his eyes with value. And it's like, okay, how am I going to speak to this person? I'm not just going to just blurt out, you know, I'm going to be quick to think, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. I mean, those are key.
I like that. And you know what? I like, I mean, I respect your faith a lot. Like, it's a dedication, it's a discipline, and it's amazing. I mean, you and Maria Shriver are the two people who really, walk that walk. And I like, I think it's comforting to people to hear that not only business, but relationships, both, it's really not about bells and whistles and light. I always say you can make a life, you can create a lifestyle out of a life. You can't create a life out of a lifestyle. So people are always worried about what everybody else thinks, lifestyle, and people are worried about Instagram selfies and filters, and like you're going to create a whole business from either being on TV or being social media famous, which is like the low-hanging fruit that sort of is just like all the shiny objects. But it's comforting. It's not so sexy, but it's comforting to hear and know that business and relationships our old school hard work period. Doesn't matter if it's 1800 or if it's 2021. It's the same story.
Yeah. You know, Bethenny, I have not figured out any way around that. You're absolutely right. It's hard work. It's good work.
Same thing with your weight, your body, your health. Yeah. Yeah. Good for, that's good. I think that's comforting because everybody gets the keys to that. Everybody can have a successful relationship. Everybody could be successful, have a successful business. There's no shortcut.
Oh, and Bethenny, something you said that is so relevant too. I mean, I have had really famous people come to me and tell me that, you know, they're trying to build a brand, but it's like really hard work. And there's nothing wrong with a celebrity endorsement if that's what you want. But as far as building a brand, I mean, that takes a lot more than an autographed photo or, you know.
That's why celebrities are brands, but they don't have brands. And that, I mean, literally, I can think of five that do. It's not easy to build a brand. To be a brand is a different story. To be really famous and, like you said, slap your name on something or take a picture is very different than building a brand with your name or without your name, just any brand. So that's
any brand. Yeah, I mean, the average lifespan of a brand is 5 years.
And I didn't know that. That makes me happy. I can't believe we've made it over a decade. Wow, that's amazing.
Well, Bethenny, you are amazing. I mean, what you've built is incredible, and you're inspiring and empowering so many people. I was so excited to get the invitation to be with you because I have so much respect for you and what you've built. And we certainly don't take it for granted that this is the 28th year of our brand. But to build a brand, I mean, you've got to have an understanding of who you're serving and price to value ratio and, you know, what it is that you're seeking to accomplish, infrastructure, all of it. It's got to be in place.
Absolutely. I'm very impressed by you. So I will ask the last question, which is, this is nothing to do with, this is purely business, not your family, not giving birth to your kids, this is the rose and thorn of your career. What is the rose and what has been the thorn?
Let's see. Thorn, I'll start with that. Our company bumped into bankruptcy. Not us personally, but it was at a time when we had one major retailer carrying our products, our socks, and which that brand grew. It grew to include a complete line of apparel and accessories. And at that point in time, we had 37 team members with families on payroll, and the bank called to set up a lunch. And I'd enjoyed lunch with the bank on many occasions, always sharing our business plan. This time was very, very different. I mean, it was just so different, you know, reaching for the check. One of the kind elderly bankers just said, you know, if this doesn't work out, we could take away all your homes. And it was very chilling.
Jarring.
It was also very eye-opening. And we came through it. You know, there were a lot of 24/7 days. It was hard work. And I would say the rose is the gift of being able, despite all the naysayers, despite people saying it couldn't be done. I love to be underestimated. Mm-hmm. That's a powerful place to be. I love that. Being able to grow and to have a business today that provides so many jobs and so many services. And I'd say the biggest rose is the nonprofit work that we are privileged to be able to be involved with, that supports people all over the world. And that's what inspires our team.
And did you thrive or simply survive during the pandemic? Did your business thrive or survive?
Bethenny, we were very grateful. I really believe because we've been pivoting since day one, it allowed us to continue to pivot without missing a beat. And again, I work with an incredible team. I love this team. They're family. And we worked really hard. I'd say, you know, we're working harder, we're working differently, but bringing great solutions to people in this time. So I'm incredibly grateful for what we've been able to do despite the pandemic.
Well, it's amazing. You're talking very much about not only how you can have a business where you are profitable and you're also helping other people. You're doing two different things at the same time. and they're all, you know, colliding in a beautiful way. So are converging in a beautiful way. So I think it's amazing. I think it's great that you're a good example of someone who, when the snow globe was shaken during COVID, everybody just has to collect themselves, take a deep breath, and that's when things usually go sideways. But it's all about how you approach something. You've learned more from your mistakes than your successes, and these are the times that define us. So I feel the same way about the pandemic. It was like, how do we do things differently? Shake it up, take a deep breath, don't be stunned, and just execute. So I this has been a great conversation. You were one of the first people I thought of wanting to speak to when I created the filter and the brand of what this show is.
Oh, Bethenny, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. That means so much coming from you.
So I appreciate your time. And I just think it's amazing what you're doing and will help a lot of people. So I'm glad you talked with us today. So that was Kathy Ireland. She is a mogul. She is a powerhouse, a businesswoman who started out as a model. She became a Sports Illustrated swimsuit model. She seems like someone who's been underestimated many times in her life. And she has a multi-billion dollar conglomerate that has many brands and businesses underneath it. Faith is an unequivocal part of her brand, her motivation, her life, faith, family, then her business. There's a lot to learn from her, and she is a mogul that is not in the typical, if there's even a typical mogul package. I'm sure she's been underestimated her entire life and career, and so it's an interesting conversation from an undeniable brand builder, businesswoman, who puts helping others at the forefront of the business decisions that she makes. So she very clearly and believably is not motivated by money. So that's a different type of entrepreneur and a different lens to look through being a business person and building a brand. Well, you know, the truth is I've found that most of the people here, from Sheryl Sandberg to Matthew McConaughey, that they really haven't been primarily motivated by money. And that's something to think about when you think about building a brand and a business, your reasons for doing it, your motivation, what you really want. And if you're being true to yourself and authentic, you probably will be able to be successful at business. And another thing that I realized from Kathy that I've known, but it's continually confirmed, is that old school hard work is how to build a brand and a business, and old school hard work is how to succeed in relationships.